been a while. I'll try to muddle through here.
This song's called "Oh Come to the Altar," and if you know the words, feel free to sing along.
You got me through the system there, the guitar.
Well, are you hurt and broken within? Well, overwhelmed by the weight of your sin. Jesus is calling. Well, have you come to the end of yourself? Well, do you thirst for drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Well, oh, come to the altar. Hear the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness He was born with. Hear the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Behind your regrets and mistakes, you come today, there's no reason to wait. Your Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. You're from the ashes, a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Well, oh, come to the altar. Hear the Father's arms are open wide. Your forgiveness He was born with. Hear the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Savior, isn't He wonderful? You sing hallelujah, your Christ is risen. You bow down before Him, before He is Lord of all. Sing hallelujah, your Christ is risen. Lord, what a Savior, isn't He wonderful? You sing hallelujah, your Christ is risen. Bow down before Him, before He is Lord of all. You sing hallelujah, your Christ is risen. Well, oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Your forgiveness He was born with. You're the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Come to the altar, hear the Father's arms are open wide. Your forgiveness forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Bear your cross as you wait for the crown. You tell the world of the treasures you found.
Somebody asked me last night, they said, do you know what the sun is like? And I said, no. They said, the sun is like bread. I said, oh, really? I said, yeah. Said, it rises in the east and it sets in the waste. Okay. I thought it was funny anyway when she told me that. But hey, when I was like 9 or 10 years old, I spent the night with a friend of mine, and we got up the next morning, and his dad fixed us breakfast, and he fixed scrambled eggs, which I like scrambled eggs and bacon and toast, and everything looked fine, and I started eating, and all of a sudden, there was something chewy in the scrambled eggs, and I said, hey, what is this? And they said, it's pork brains. That's the honest truth, it's pork brains. And I said, ew. And he said, oh, we whenever we have scrambled eggs, we put pork brains in them, you know. And the two just don't seem to go together, you know, scrambled eggs and pork brains. Any of y'all ever eaten pork brains? Anybody? Oh, okay, Larry has. I noticed all the really intelligent people in our congregation said they eat pork brains. So, but they you know, some things just don't seem to go together. And like somebody was telling me, their favorite sandwich in the whole world was a peanut butter, banana, and mayonnaise sandwich. And I've never tried it. I guess I should try it before I knock it. How many of you like that sandwich? Okay, oh, look, man. I'm ignorant. I don't know what I speak of. I mean, you know, to me, it's just like peanut butter, banana, yes, I can see those going together. But mayonnaise? And I don't know. I'll have to try it. I've got to try it because I'm always fussing at Elaine because she won't try new things. And so I need to try that. I should try it before I knock. But they just don't seem to go together. And we're going to be looking at a passage of Scripture this morning, which we're going to find a couple of guys, Paul and Silas, in extreme difficulty. And yet they're going to do two things that don't seem to go together. They're going to pray, which makes sense in their situation. But they also sing hymns. And it's like, wait a minute. I totally get the prayer. You know, they're in an extreme difficult situation. And I understand crying out to God for help. But singing hymns? You know, why would you sing hymns at a time like that? It seems like you would put all of your effort into crying out to God to get me out of this situation. But yet, in the Scripture, we see that these guys not only pray, but the Bible says they sing hymns. They sing to God. It doesn't seem to go together, but yet we'll see in Scripture this morning that it really does go together. And it will point us to our next issue in the healthy church. It's a church that has prayer and praise. It's a church that goes through difficulties by employing both of these things. And both of these things are related to our walk with God. Both of these things are related to our connection with God and how we communicate with God and how we interact with God. After all, The church should be much more than a civic organization. The church should be much more than just a place we come to meet people, though that's part of it. The church should be much more than just a place where we gather together with people who we like or who are like us, though that may be part of it. But the church has a supernatural element to it because the church was created by God. It was born of God's Holy Spirit. And hopefully and prayerfully, our church is a place where God inhabits this place and God fills us and God works in us and God moves in us. And we come to church not just for social interaction, though that's part of it. We come to church to meet with God, don't we? We come to church hoping that God will meet us here and that we'll walk away from here transformed, changed, that we've had an encounter with God Almighty, that God has spoken to us as we have worshiped Him, as we have prayed to Him. So a healthy church is a church that is involved in prayer and praise. And we're going to be in Acts chapter 16, a real well-known passage of Scripture, and we're going to kind of work through that and see how this fleshes out in our church. Let's pray. Father, we thank You so much for Your love for us, and we thank You that You do care for us. And Lord, right now, as we get ready to open Your Word and to look into Your Word, Father, we pray that Your Holy Spirit would become our teacher, that Your blessed Holy Spirit would guide us to these truths, and Lord, that each one of us who've gathered in this place would go away from here with much more than just knowledge or much more than just maybe social interaction, but Lord, we would go away from here having encountered You, that Lord, You would come down and do a mighty work in our hearts, and that You would interact with us, Lord, and that we would leave here knowing that we have been in Your presence. Now, Lord, we have all kinds of things on our minds. Lord, we have all kinds of problems that we're facing next week, maybe even today. We've got issues at home. We've got issues at work. We've got all kinds of things that are just kind of floating through our minds right now. Lord, would You help us by Your grace and by Your mercy? Would You help us just to push those things out of our mind? And Lord, right now, just to focus on You and Your Word. And Lord, may Your truth just for the next few minutes consume our minds, our intellects. Lord, may we just so focus on the Word that, Lord, You can really, really speak to us in a powerful way. So, Father, just move, we pray, in Jesus' lovely name. Amen. Some people have called Acts the fifth gospel. You know, there are four gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And some people have called Acts the fifth gospel because actually Acts is a continuation of what we learn in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And it's the story of the church of Jesus Christ being born. And Jesus gives the disciples the Great Commission, tells them to go out and preach the gospel to all the world. And Acts is the fulfillment of that. We literally see the gospel of Jesus Christ spread from just a small little group in Jerusalem to literally it spreads around the entire then known world to the farthest reaches of the world at that time. And it's an exciting book. And in Acts chapter 16, we drop right into the middle of one of Paul's missionary journeys, his second missionary journey. And Paul was a converted Jew who met the Lord on the road to Damascus, and he was totally transformed. And so he started going out and telling people about Jesus Christ. And God used him in a mighty way. And Paul was mainly ministering to the north of Israel in Asia Minor, up around where Turkey is today. He was mainly ministering there, but at some point, God moves him towards Europe. And one of the most important moments in all of the story of the church is when the man from Macedonia appears to Paul in a vision at night and tells Paul, we need you to come over and help us. Now, what was so significant about that was it was God directing Paul through this vision to leave Asia and to cross over into Europe. And so the gospel had not, it's hard for us to fathom this, but the gospel had not been preached in Europe yet. And so Paul was going to preach the gospel, and he was going to see the first convert in Europe. And we pick up in Acts chapter 16 and verse 14, and a certain woman named Lydia from the city of Thyatira a seller of purple fabrics, a worshiper of God, was listening. Now, she wasn't saved. She wasn't a Christian at this point. She did worship God as a Jew. She recognized who God was, but she wasn't converted yet. Look what the Bible says. And the Lord opened her heart to respond. What does that mean? That meant that the Holy Spirit of God was working in her heart, was convicting her of her sin. And any person who ever becomes a Christian, any person who ever is born again, God has to do a work in their heart. God has to open their eyes to see that they are a sinner, that they need salvation, and they have a desire for salvation. That's why so many times you talk to people and they're not interested. They don't want to hear anything about the Bible. They don't want to hear anything about God. They're totally not interested at all. Why? Because the Holy Spirit of God has not really worked and dealt with their heart. But here we have a case where Lydia is under the inspiration and guidance of the Holy Spirit. And the Lord opens her heart to the things that were spoken by Paul. And so she trusted Christ as her Savior. In verse 15, the Bible says, when she and her household had been baptized, she urged us, said, Lord, if you have judges to be faithful to the Lord, come into my house and stay. And she prevailed upon us. Now, what was so interesting, when Paul arrived there in Philippi, there was no synagogue there at all. So the Jews were instructed that if you didn't have a synagogue, you're supposed to go down by the riverside. And every Sabbath day, the Jews were to gather by the riverside, and they were to have kind of just a casual prayer meeting by the riverside because they didn't have a synagogue. So the Apostle Paul is walking by the river looking for Jews, and the Bible tells us that he found a group of women assembled by the river in verse 13 who were having a prayer meeting. And that's when he starts talking to them about the gospel of Jesus Christ. And this actually is the birth of the church in Europe. It's actually the birth of the church of Jesus Christ in Europe, and it starts out with a small group of women, and those who trust Christ, they form the nucleus of the church. Now, this is exciting. Okay, great, man. This is how the church is supposed to operate. You preach the gospel, people believe, and they form a nucleus, and then that nucleus begins to grow, and the church begins to develop, and it's exciting to see the birth of a church. And, you know, one of the things that I'll always be thankful for was I was a part of the start of a church. It's exciting. It's exciting to be in on the ground floor of the birth of a church. It's exciting to see a church formed and then just to see it grow and develop and blossom. And, you know, it's kind of like Eric was talking in his prayer letter. You know, he's thinking about buying that church, the Methodist church that's closing down. Isn't that exciting that maybe Eric, one of our missionaries, may take this abandoned church and turn it around, and we'll actually see that maybe the rebirth of a church in a great and exciting way. So it's a wonderful thing. But right away in the book of Acts, we see something that we see over and over again in the book of Acts, is whenever God begins to move, whenever God begins to do something, there is always going to be opposition to that. One of the things that we have to understand is that we live in a fallen world, and we have an enemy who walks about seeking whom he may devour, and his name is Satan. So whenever God begins to move, whenever that movement happens, there's always going to be opposition. And this is exactly what happens in Acts chapter 16. The Bible says in verse 16, and it happened that as they were going to the place of prayer, a certain slave girl having a spirit of divination met us, who was bringing her master's much profit or money by fortune telling. Following after Paul and us, she kept crying out, verse 17, saying, these men are bondservants or slaves of the Most High God who are proclaiming to you the way of salvation. Now, here is kind of in a nutshell how Satan operates against the church. Satan will try to do two things against the church. First of all, he will try to infiltrate the church. You know, he will try to bring in false teachers. He will try to bring in people that will divide the church or split the church up, or he'll try to infiltrate the church. So here we have kind of a picture of this. Here we have this poor slave girl who is demon possessed, and she's prophesying and she's telling the future, and it's all a money making scheme for her masters, and it's kind of pitiful. They're taking advantage of her. But, you know, you say, well, wait a minute, what she said was right. Bondservants of the Most High God. Yes, she is speaking truth, but I think that she's speaking truth because she's trying to infiltrate this a group of this baby group of believers who've just formed a church. And so they're trying to infiltrate this group, and Satan is trying to infiltrate through this demon-possessed young lady. Well, right away, Paul recognizes this, and she kept crying this out over and over again, and she kept doing this for many days, according to verse 18. So Paul was greatly annoyed. That gives me great comfort that pastors do get annoyed. And so Paul got greatly annoyed and turned to her and said to the spirit that she was possessed with, "I command you in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her." So Paul recognized this for what it was, and so he cast the demon out of her. He recognized that it was satanic action against this infant church that had just been formed. So he cast her out. So now, if Satan can't infiltrate a church, then he'll do the second thing. If he can't infiltrate a church, he will try to destroy the church by persecution. So if he can't cause the church to stumble from the inside, then he will do the second thing. He will attack the church from the outside. And this is exactly what's going to happen. So the masters in verse 9, the ones who owned this poor slave girl in verse 19, "But when her masters saw that their hope of profit was gone, they seized Paul and Silas and dragged them into the marketplace before the authorities." So here we see Satan now shifting into a second plan of attack. He couldn't infiltrate this group, so what does he do? He's, okay, well, I'm just going to just outright just attack them. I'm just going to come against them. And so the owners of the slave girl dragged them into a public place, a marketplace, before the authorities. And when they had brought them to the chief magistrates, they said, "These men are throwing our city into confusion," in verse 20, being Jews. Or right away we can see there was a prejudice against Jews. They hated Jews. And so they used this as a tool, and they said, "These Jews have come into our city," and Philippi was a very important Roman outpost. They were very proud of their Roman heritage. They were very proud of many of them being Roman citizens in that city. And so immediately they used this, and they said, "These men are," in verse 20, "these men are throwing our city into confusion, being Jews, and are proclaiming customs which is not lawful for us to accept or to observe, being Romans." So they drag them in, and so suddenly the crowd is just enraged, and they're worked into a frenzy. And the Bible says in verse 22, the crowd rose up together against them, against Paul and Silas. And the chief magistrates tore their robes off. They literally tore the outer garments of Paul and Silas off. And they proceeded to order them to be beaten with rods. Now, there were these men called lictors that they carried around these bundle of rods with an axe in them. And their job was to enforce the laws of the land. And part of the way that they enforced the laws was they took these rods that were about the size of a man's thumb in thickness, and they would literally beat somebody with these rods. And this is about to happen to Paul and Silas. So this church that started out with so much potential, this church that started out with a wonderful story of salvation and Lydia getting saved by the river, suddenly there's a great reversal. And if you're following along the outline, write the word reversal in there. There's a great reversal here. Because when the church starts out, it looks like, hey, this is great. People are being saved, and these ladies got saved by the river, and man, this church is off to a good start. And then suddenly, almost instantaneously, everything turns around, and now Paul and Silas, who have preached the gospel, suddenly their outer garments are stripped off, and they are beaten with these rods. And the Jews, remember the Jews had the law that you could only beat somebody 39 times, and that was a strict Jewish law. But remember, this is not a Jewish town. This is not a Jewish system. This is a Roman system, so they could beat them as much as they wanted to. And most people said, most things that I read said they would beat them till they were almost incapacitated. They would beat them till their backs just became a bloody mess and even exposed bones. And it was just horrible beating. So here is Paul and Silas. They rip off their outer garments. And then they had inflicted many blows upon them, and they threw them into prison. So here is Paul and Silas. Everything seems to be going good. And then suddenly there's a great reversal. So what's going to happen to this baby church? Is it just going to shrivel up and blow away? I mean, this church that started out with such good promise, Lydia getting saved and the ladies by the river, what is going to happen to this church? Is it just going to dissolve and drift away and disappear? Paul and Silas now are thrown into jail, and it's pretty obvious there was a lot of animosity towards them, because the Bible says they, after many blows, and the emphasis in verse 23 is on the word many, talking about how many blows were given to Paul and Silas, were thrown into the inner prison and fastened their feet in stocks. Now, why is this significant? Well, they hated Paul and Silas so much because of what they were doing, they didn't just throw them into jail, they threw them into the inner prison. And the inner prison was the inner cell that was the most secure place in the prison. It was reserved for the most notorious criminals. You only got placed into the inner cell or the inner jail if you were a very notorious criminal. So here is Paul and Silas. They were thrown into the inner cell, and the other prisoners were out around them, circling around them. But Paul and Silas were put into the most secure place. And secondly, their feet were put in stocks. Now, that didn't happen to every prisoner. You know, if you were caught for stealing or a minor crime or something, your feet weren't put in stock. You were just thrown into the jail cell with a bunch of other prisoners. But Paul and Silas's feet were put in stock. Do you know why they put their feet in stocks? You got any idea why they did that? They wanted them to be secure. It's obvious they put them in the most secure place. But there was a second reason. When they put your feet in stocks and your back is a bloody mess, and you're leaning against the wall, what is your natural tendency when your back is just ripped open and just sore and bleeding? What is your natural tendency? You don't want to lay on it, do you? You want to try to get comfortable. You want to try to roll over, get on your side. And what happens when your feet are put in stocks? You can't roll over. You're stuck. So here are Paul and Silas. They're in the inner cell. They're in the inner, the most secure part of the jail. Their feet are in stocks. Their back is a bloody mess. They can't turn over. They can't roll. I don't know about you. That's pretty bad, isn't it? That's a pretty big reversal. Paul and Silas go from successful ministry, people being saved, beaten publicly, arrested, thrown into the most secure part of the jail, feet put in stocks. And so here they are in a dark, damp dungeon cell. Their feet are in stocks. Their back is a bloody mess. They're in pain. So they went from this mountaintop experience of seeing somebody saved to now they're in the worst possible situation. So what are they going to do? Well, the Bible says in the next verse, they called for their attorney and wanted to have a session with their legal representation. Oh, wait a minute. Oh, that's in the Greek. You can't read that in English. No, there's a terrible reversal. And so the Bible says in verse 24, they threw them into the inner prison and fastened their feet in stocks in verse 24. So now I want you to look at Paul and Silas's response. We had a reversal, but now this is the response. Now, a healthy church is going to be able to respond to adversity. An unhealthy church can be destroyed by adversity. Now, how do we know that this little teeny baby church that just came to life is a healthy church? I want you to notice Paul and Silas's response to this terrible reversal. Look in verse 25. But about midnight, the darkest hour of the night, you know, most literature, when they talk about the midnight hour, what are they talking about? They're talking about the darkest time, the darkest possible time you could think of, midnight. And so what's the Bible say in verse 25? About midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns of praise to God, and the prisoners were listening to them. Now, this response is unbelievable. This response is off the charts. How could anybody in that situation respond this way? I mean, they were thrown into jail. They went from mountaintop to the worst possible situation. How could they possibly respond this way? There's only one answer. You say, well, they were Paul and Silas. That's why. You know, they were these great spirituals. No, I don't think that's the answer. I think the Spirit of God was giving them the power to do that. You know, the only way that you can pray in adversity and truly pray is direction by the Spirit of God. The Spirit of God filling you. You know, if you are overwhelmed by some adversity, you know what your normal reaction is to get angry, to get mad at God. Remember what Job's wife said to him? Anybody remember that? She was such a sweet, submissive wife. She looked at Job and she said, why don't you just curse God and die? You know, wonderful counsel. She just loved the Lord so much. She said, why don't you just curse God and die? And you know, that is the normal, natural reaction. Okay, God is supposed to fix everything in my life. Everything's supposed to go smooth. Everything's supposed to go fine. I'm not supposed to have any problems. I'm not supposed to have any adversity. I'm not supposed to have any difficulty. So when problems come in, unless the Spirit of God is working in your heart and guiding and directing in your life, your normal reaction is going to be to get angry at God. God, I tried to serve you. Paul and Silas, couldn't they have looked at God and said, hey, wait a minute, we came here to preach the gospel. And what do we get? We get thrown into jail. We come here to tell people about the Lord Jesus Christ, and what do we get? We get beaten. Our outer garments are stripped off. We get beaten on the back with these rods. Is that the thanks we get for trying to serve you, God? They could have said all of that, but they didn't. You know, you say, well, it was because their moral character. It was because they were great spiritual giants. I think it was because the Spirit of God was doing something fantastic in their hearts and in their midst. You know, the only way any church is going to get through any adversity or problem is the Spirit of God. You know what? That's why when a church is going through difficulty and problem, the church needs a revival. The church needs the Spirit of God to work in its midst. The church needs the Spirit of God to come and revive us. That means to give us fresh life, to renew our life, to restore us to a spiritual place. So what is happening in Acts chapter 16, verse 25 at midnight? The Spirit of God is doing a great work in Paul and Silas. How do you know that? Well, first of all, they're praying. God has led them not to get angry and yell at him, but instead to cry out to him. The Bible doesn't tell us what they were praying about or what they were praying for. We don't know that. I would assume that in that situation, they were praying for deliverance. They may have been praying for the little church that they just saw born by the riverside. They may have been praying for the whole city of Philippi. I'm not sure what they prayed for, but the fact is that they were praying. And you know something, you know, if you ever want to judge your spirituality, if you want to judge where you are spiritually, observe the next time you have a crisis come into your life. What do you do when suddenly your finances bottom out, or your relationship goes south, or your marriage is in trouble, or you're about to lose your job, or the doctor gives you a bad report? How do you respond to that? Do you get angry at God and say, God, you know, why did you let that happen? Or is there something inside of you that says you need to pray about this? Is there something inside of you that's leading you to seek God more than you've ever sought God? Is there something inside of you that's causing you to lift up your eyes into the hills from whence comes your help? Is there something moving inside of you? Well, Paul and Silas, the Bible says at midnight, in their feet in stocks, their back ripped open, the Bible says they start praying. It's interesting, when Paul wrote to the church at Philippi, in Philippians, it's interesting that he says to the Christians at Philippi, after this was after all this had happened, he writes a letter back to the church at Philippi, and he says to them, he says, don't be anxious about anything, which is amazing. You know, sometimes I wish that verse wasn't in the Bible because I get under conviction so much. Do you ever worry? Do you ever worry? Am I the only one that worries? You know, am I the only one with gray hair? Am I the only one that gets anxious about things? I worry. But you know what Paul says in Philippians? He says, be anxious for nothing. He said, don't worry about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. Now, how do you do that? It goes against everything in our human fiber. It goes against everything in our human being to cry out to God at this time. We want to accuse God. We want to get angry at God. But here we see Paul and Silas. They are led into a place of prayer. Now, here's the cool thing. They are led beyond prayer. They're led to pray, Lord, to get us out of this situation, help us out of the situation. But then something amazing happens. Something astounding happens. The Bible says they start singing. What? How can you sing at a time like this? Your back is a bloody mess. Your legs are in stocks. How can you possibly sing? It's midnight. Your ministry has been cut off. You're in jail. You don't know how long you're going to be in jail. How can you possibly sing? Paul, Silas, you know, what are you? What kind of pill are you taking? What kind of dope are you smoking? What is going on with you? How can you possibly sing at midnight? Paul said in Ephesians chapter 5, he said, be not drunk with wine wherein is excess, but keep on being filled with the Spirit of God. You know what Acts 16 is evidence of? Believers who are controlled by God by the Holy Spirit. Because the Bible says in Ephesians 5:18, don't be drunk with wine, but keep on being filled with the Spirit of God. And then the very next phrase is speaking to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Do you know how you know when somebody's controlled by the Spirit of God? Do you know how you know when somebody is full of God? They can sing in the darkest hour. They can sing when everything is wrong. They can sing when everything is bad. So here is Paul and Silas at midnight, and they're praying. God is leading them to pray, and God is leading them to sing. And the prisoners are listening to this. Remember, they were in the inner cell. All the other cells were around them. So these other guys are listening. They're saying, what is going on? It's kind of like me listening to Ronald sing while he cleans the church. What is going on? You know, what is that? What is that? And they're saying, wait a minute. Those guys are in the high security, maximum security cell. Their feet are strapped to the floor. Their backs are ripped open. We saw them when they came in. And they're singing, Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I know that song didn't exist. I know, I understand that. But still, some of you will come up and correct me after the service. But anyway, you know, so they're in there singing and they're praising God, and it's totally a supernatural response. My point is, they didn't respond in the flesh. When we face problems and difficulties, our human tendency is, I can fix this. I've got a plan. I can call somebody. I can get a loan. I can figure this out. They didn't say, call my attorney. They didn't respond in the flesh. They respond in the Spirit. What does the Bible say? The Bible says they started praying, and God led them in that prayer to the point where suddenly that prayer moved on from prayer, from asking God for something, to thanking God in faith. How could they do that? There's only one answer. It's through the Holy Spirit of God. They were filled with the Spirit of God. God was working in their hearts. God was moving in their hearts. And so there was this wonderful thing that was happening between God and his servants, Paul and Silas. And you know what? When God's people yield to God, and God fills them, and God controls them, and God moves in their hearts, wonderful things can happen. You know how you can see a healthy church? It's when the individual members of that church are yielded to God. It's when the individual members are yielded to God. It's when the individual members are allowing the Spirit of God to lead them in prayer, the Spirit of God to lead them into singing, and all of a sudden worship doesn't just become something that you stand up and do a couple times a week in a church service. Suddenly it becomes the very expression of who you are. It becomes the expression of your heart, and suddenly you catch a fresh vision of who God is. And you want to worship him, you want to praise him, and you want to thank him, and you want to adore him. And so here's Paul and Silas. And suddenly, do you see what's happened here? Do you see what God has done? Paul and Silas were in the inner cell, everything wrong in their life. And what was their mind filled up with at that moment? Their mind was filled up with, oh no, we're in pain, we're in jail, we may never get out of jail. What about these new converts? What about these new people that we just led to the Lord? What's going to happen? You know, what's going to happen to this baby church that we just saw birth? And all these things were going through their head. And some of you walked into church service this morning and everything is whirling around in your head, and it's still there for some of you. You haven't heard anything I've said because you're thinking about the bill you've got to pay, or the doctor's visit next week, or you're thinking about the stress in your relationship. There's something that's just dominating your mind. But you know what happened with Paul and Silas? They got into that inner cell, and they started praying. And the more they prayed, the more these things left their heart and their mind. You know what Paul said in Philippians? He said, if you pray like that, he said, the peace of God that passes all understanding, will keep your hearts and your minds through Christ Jesus. Now guess, look what we're seeing happening here in the Bible. We're seeing a miracle before our eyes. We're seeing Paul and Silas walk in, beaten, abused, locked in jail, and the Spirit of God begins to lead them to pray and to sing hymns. And guess what happens? All those thoughts begin to go away. What's going to happen to church? It's gone. God's going to take care of it. What's going to happen to us? My back hurts so bad. Poof, it's gone. God's going to take care of that. How long are we going to be in jail? How long are we going to stay? Poof, it's gone. And one by one, those things begin to leave their mind. And guess what's left when all those things go? Guess what's left when the worries are gone? Guess what's left when what's going to happen tomorrow is gone? Guess what happens with all the anxiety? Guess what's God's left. You know what? Suddenly, Paul and Silas, all this leaves. They saw, and suddenly they say, wow, you know, God is bigger than this situation. God is greater than this jail. God is greater than the Roman Empire. God's not going to let this church die. God's not going to let us die. God's going to do something great. And just about that moment, they felt something move. Then they felt something else move. They thought it was the pizza they had the other night, but it wasn't that. And the ground begins to shake and everything begins to move. And suddenly the Bible says there was a great earthquake. Now Philippi was known for the earthquakes. It wasn't the miracle that there was an earthquake. The miracle was the timing of the earthquake. Notice this earthquake came just as the moment that they were praising God and lifting God up. Immediately the jail begins to shake, and miraculously all the doors are open and every single prisoner in there, their chains fell off. Isn't that fantastic? And what has happened? What has transpired before our eyes? Suddenly God has entered in and God has said, okay, I'm going to take the worries, I'm going to take them out of your head. These anxieties, I'm going to take them out of your head. And when I get all this out of your head and out of your heart, I'm going to flood you with the reality of me. And you're going to see your world changed. You're going to see your world transformed. The jail started to shake. And I don't have time. I'm out of time. But you know the rest of the story. The jailer runs in and says, what must I do to be saved? Wait a minute. I thought the church was dead. I thought Paul and Silas were in jail. The church was finished. Wait a minute. There's another person getting saved. Then the family gets saved. And then they come in and the whole family, the whole household gets saved. And guess what we're seeing? We're seeing God supernaturally say, okay, here's the church at Philippi. I'm doing a mighty work. And they let Paul and Silas out. And all that anxiety and all that fear that they had for a few moments while they were in there is gone. And they look around and they say, look what God did. Look what God did. Look what God did. Would you not like to be a part of a church like that? Would you not like to be a part of a church where people come together? We've got all our problems. We got all our difficulty. All God's children have problems. Amen. The Bible says it rains on the just and the unjust. Every one of us could stand up right now and talk about aches and pains and financial woes and family problems and job problems. The list could go on and on. But wouldn't it be fantastic if, as a body of Christ, we could come together and say, oh, Lord, for the next few moments, this is your time. Oh, God, I just want to push this aside for a little while. I'm going to take this problem. I'm going to set it aside. Right now, I want to focus on you. My eyes are on you, Lord. I want to focus on you, God. I want you to be my center. I want you to be everything that I think about. I want to worship you. And can you imagine if we had a church full of people that did that through prayer and praise, that God would come and the result would be unbelievable. Why? Because there would be a group of people who are focused on God and nothing else. And God would just begin to move and do a great and a fantastic work. So prayer, God-inspired directed prayer, plus God-inspired praise equals power. It equals God moving in a great and a fantastic way. And I don't know about you, but that's my definition of a healthy church. When people come together in spite of their problems. Am I minimizing your problems? No. Am I minimizing your hurt? No. I understand every one of you. Every one of you have problems and difficult. I do too. But what I'm saying is, if the Spirit of God could lead us as we come to worship, if the Spirit of God could lead us to pray, to set those things aside and to focus on God, and if we would start looking at our problems through the lens of God, everything would look different. But you know what our problem is? We look at all our problems through the lens of ourselves. How am I going to solve this? How am I going to work this out? Where can I get the money to pay this bill? We had several people call the church this week and said, we have nowhere to live. We have nowhere to go. Can you help us find a place to spend the night? I mean, can you imagine going through life, looking at life through that lens, and all you see is, what can I do? And what's going to happen when you look through that lens? You're going to get overwhelmed, aren't you? I can't handle this problem. I can't handle this difficulty. I can't handle this loss. It's too great for me. But hey, supposing that lens changed and the lens became God, and suddenly you start saying, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. For with God, nothing shall be impossible. Call unto me, and I will answer thee and show thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not. Call upon me in the day of trouble, and I will deliver. Suddenly we start looking at our problems through the lens of God. God could shake some jails for us, amen? God could set some prisoners free, amen? God could lead some people to Christ, amen? Just as he did in Acts chapter 16, he could do it in our lives. What? If we just wait before him, no matter what the problems, no matter how much Satan tries to distract us, no matter how much he tries to throw us curveballs, no matter how much he tries to get us off track, we got to keep our eyes on Jesus. We got to keep our eyes on God. We got to keep focused so that God can work in our hearts as a church. Amen? Oh, dear friend, do you want that kind of prayer and praise in your life? Do you want that kind of power in your life? I do. I do. I really do. I want God to help me to set aside all the problems and difficulties and stresses and distractions. And just through his Holy Spirit, allow me to focus on him. Let's pray. I know if you're a typical congregation, you came to this church service with things in your heart and on your mind, things that are weighing you down, things that are so heavy to you, things that are so hurtful to you. Some of you, it took all your energy just to get up and come to church this morning. You said, why should I even go? Why should I even try? Look at my life. Look how my life is messed up. Dear friend, would you believe this morning? Would you believe God? Would you be willing to say, Lord, just for a few moments, just for a brief moment, I want to set all my problems aside. I want to set all my difficulties aside. God, I just want a fresh vision of you. I want a fresh perspective of you. I want to know, God, that you're greater than anything I face. That you're all powerful and you can do all things, God. And Lord, just for a brief moment, let me just set aside all these things that are just filling my mind and my heart. And let me follow the example of Paul and Silas. Let me pray and sing hymns. Let me focus on you, God. Let me see you, God, shake some jails in my life and shake some problems that I'm facing. Oh, God, let me see you work in my life, God, please. Give me grace. Let your Holy Spirit work in my heart. Help me focus on you, God, please. I'm going to pray and close the service. I wonder if there's anybody here this morning who said, Pastor, would you pray for me? I really want to focus on God. There's so many things distracting me in my life. Thank you. I really want to thank you. Thank you all over the building. Thank you all over the building. God bless you. I want to focus on God, but there's so many things that are trying to take my attention away. So many things diverting me. There's so many things that are confusing me. There's so many things that are just rushing at me from all way. Oh, Pastor, would you pray for me that I could focus on God? Please, Pastor, would you pray for me? Anybody else, right before we pray, let's pray. Oh, Father, what a wonderful story you've given to us in the Bible. Thank you, Lord, for the story of Paul and Silas. Oh, God, who in spite of the horrible situation they found themselves in, they could focus on you, God. And, Lord, I want to pray for, Lord, there must have been 12 or 15 hands that went up all over this place, Lord. Lord, so many people struggling, so many people hurting. Lord, so many people just trying to make it through from one day to the next. Oh, God, please help them. Help them by your grace and through your power. Help them to be able to push those things aside, to get those things out of their head and out of their heart. Lord, help them not to be overcome with anxiety. But, Lord, by prayer, with thanksgiving, Lord, may they be able to focus on you. And, Lord, do a work in their life, in their heart. Lord, shake some jails for them. Lord, come and move in a great way in their lives. Answer prayers for them, Father. Help them, Lord. We pray for them. And, oh, God, give them grace and give them faith. Oh, God, help them through your Holy Spirit to be able to stand strong in a time of terrible adversity. Oh, God, bless them, we pray. Oh, Lord, help them stand true to your word. Help them rest upon your promises, God. Please, Father, please work in their hearts. And, Lord, for our whole congregation, Lord, for our whole church, may we become a church known as a church, Lord, that prays, and a church that sings hymns and praises you, Lord. And help us to be known as a church that sets aside problems and difficulties and focuses on you, God, and you alone. Oh, God, please help us. Help us to be that kind of church. Oh, move in our hearts, Lord, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you guys. Thanks for being here. You're dismissed. Thanks for coming.